Has my good-for-nothing young son been here?
I don't think Lord Gore has arrived yet.
Why do you call Lord Gore good-for-nothing?
Well, because he leads such an idle life.
How can you say such a thing? Why, he rides in a row at 10 o'clock in the morning. He goes to the opera 3 times a week, changes his clothes at least 5 times a day, and dines out every night of the season. You don't call that leading an idle life, do you?
You're such a charming young lady.
How sweet of you to say that, Lady Havisham. Do you come to us more often?
I never go anywhere now. I'm sick of London society.
Oh, I love London society. I think it has immensely improved. It is entirely composed now of beautiful idiots and brilliant lunatics. Just what society should be.
And which is Goring? The beautiful idiot or the other thing?
I've been obliged for the present to put Lord Goring into a class quite by himself. But he is developing charmingly.
Into what?
I hope to let you know very soon, Lady Capshaw.
Lady Markbit, Mrs. Jeebly.
Let me train my friend, Mrs. Cheesy. Two such charming women should know each other.
I think Mrs. Cheesy and I have met before. I did not know she had married a second time.
Oh, well, nowadays people get married as often as possible, don't they? It's most fashionable.
But have you really met before, Lady Chilton? I can't remember where. I have been out of England for such a long time.
We were up school together, Mrs. Cheesy.
I have forgotten more about my school days. I think they were quite detestable.
I'm not surprised.
Do you know, I'm quite looking forward to meeting your clever husband, Lady Chilton. Since he's been at the Foreign Office, he has been so much talked of in Vienna. They've even spelt his name right in the newspapers, which is in itself fame on the continent.
I hardly think there'll be much going to you or my husband.
Good evening, Lady Markby. I do hope you brought Sir John with you.
Oh, no. I brought a far more charming guest than Sir John. Sir John's temper, now he's taking seriously to politics, has become quite unbearable. Really, now the House of Commons is trying to become useful, it does a great deal of harm.
I hope not, Lady Markbeats. Anyway, we do our best to waste the public time, don't we? Who is this charming person you've been kind enough to bring to us?
Her name's Mrs. Cheevy. One of the Devonshire's Cheevies, I suppose. But I don't know. Indeed, as a rule, everyone ends up being somebody else.
Mrs. Cheevy? I seem to know the name.
She's just arrived from Vienna.
Ah, yes. I think I know whom you mean.
Oh, she goes everywhere there and has such splendid scandal about all her friends. I really must go to the Vienna in the wintertime. I do hope there's a good shot at the embassy.
If there is not, the ambassador will certainly have to be recalled. But pray, do point out Mrs. Cheevy to me. I should like to see her.
Let me introduce you. My dear, Sir Robert Chilton is dying to know you.
Everyone is dying to know the brilliant Mrs. Cheevy. Our attachés in Vienna write to us about nothing else.
Thank you, Sir Robert. An acquaintance that begins with a compliment is sure to become a real friendship. Starts in the right manner. And I find I already know Lady Chilton.
Really?
Yes, that's just reminded me we were at school together. And I remember perfectly now. Lady Chilton always got the good conduct prize. Yes, I have a distinct recollection of Lady Chilton always winning the good conduct prize.
And what prizes do you get, Mrs. Chilton?
Oh, my prizes came rather later in life, and I'm not sure any were ever for good conduct. I forget.
I'm sure they were for something, charming.
I'm not sure winning are always rewarded for being charming. In fact, I think they are usually punished for it. That's certainly why nowadays women grow old because of the faithfulness of their admirers, not through anything else. At least it's the only way I can account for the terribly haggard looks of your pretty women in London.
What an appalling philosophy that sounds. To attempt to classify you, Mrs. Cheevy, would be an impertinence. But tell me, at heart, are you an optimist or a pessimist? Those seem to be the only two fashion religions left open to us nowadays.
Oh, I'm neither. Optimism begins in such a broad grin, and pessimism ends in such blue spectacles. And besides, they are both of them mere poses.
You prefer to be natural?
Sometimes, but that is such a difficult pose to keep up.
What would those modern psychological novelists, of whom we hear so much, say to such a theory as that?
Ah, the strength of women is that psychology cannot explain us. Men may be analysed, but women merely adored.
You think science cannot grapple with the problem of women?
Science can never grapple with the irrational, and that is why there's no future for it in this world.
Women represent the irrational.
Well-dressed women do.
I fear I could hardly agree with you there. And tell me, what makes you leave your brilliant Vienna for our gloomy London? Or perhaps the question is indiscreet?
Questions are never indiscreet. Answers often are.
Well, at any rate, may I know, is it politics or pleasure?
Politics are my only pleasure. You see, nowadays it's not fashionable to flirt till one is 40, or to be romantic till one is 45. So we poor women under 30, what we say we are, we have no option open to us except politics or philanthropy. And philanthropy, it seems to me, is simply the refuge of those who wish to annoy their fellow creatures. So I prefer politics, it's more becoming.
Political life is a noble career.
Sometimes. And sometimes it is a clever game, Sir Robert. And sometimes it's a great nuisance. Now, may I walk through your beautiful house? I hear your paintings are charming.
Poor Baron Arnheim. You remember the Baron? He used to tell me that you had the most wonderful collars.
Did you know Baron Arnheim well?
Intimately, did you?
One time.
Wonderful man, wasn't he?
He was a very remarkable man in many ways.
I think it's a great pity that the Baron never wrote his memoirs. They would have made it very interesting.
I'm sorry I did not stay away sooner. I like being this.
How very selfish of you.
I am very selfish.
You were always telling me of your bad qualities, Lord Goring.
I already told you half of them as yet, Miss Mabel.
Oh. Are the others very bad?
Oh, quite dreadful. When I think of them at night, I go to sleep at once.
Well, I delight in your bad qualities. I wouldn't have you part with one of them.
Oh, very nice of you. But then you're always nice. By the way, I have a question to ask you, Mabel. Who brought Mrs. Cheeby here? That woman in scarlet who just went out of the room with your brother.
Oh, I think Lady Markby brought her. Why do you ask?
I haven't seen her for years, that is all.
What an absurd reason.
All reasons are absurd.
What sort of a woman is she?
Oh, a genius in the daytime and a beauty at night.
I dislike her already.
But she's not admirable with taste.
Well, Sarah, what are you doing here? Wasting your life, as usual. You should be in bed, sir. You keep too late hours. I heard of you the other night with Lady Raffles, dancing to 4 o'clock in the morning.
Only a quarter,
mother. Don't know how you stand on your society. The thing has gone to the dogs. Just a lot of damn... Nobody's talking about nothing.
I adore talking about nothing, mother. It's the only thing I know anything about.
You seem to me to be living entirely for pleasure.
What else is there to live for, mother? Nothing ages like happiness.
You're heartless, sir. Very heartless.
I hope not, mother. Good evening, Lady Basildon.
Are you here? I had no idea you ever came to political parties.
I adore political parties. They're the only place I've thought that people don't talk.
I delight in talking politics. I talk them all day long. But I can't bear listening to them. I don't know how the unfortunate men in the House stand those long debates.
By never listening.
Oh, really?
Yes, of course. You see, it is a very dangerous thing to listen. If one listens, then one may be convinced. And a man who allows himself to be convinced is a thoroughly unreasonable person.
That accounts for so much in men that I cannot understand, and so much in women that their husbands never appreciated them.
Our husbands never appreciate anything in us. We must go to others for that.
Those are the views of the two ladies who are known to have the most admirable husbands in London.
That is exactly what we can't stand. My Reginald is quite hopelessly faultless. Sometimes unendurably so. There is not the smallest element of excitement in knowing him.
Terrible. Really, officially more widely known.
Basildon is quite as bad. He's as domestic as if he was a bachelor.
Oh, my dear Margaret, we have married perfect husbands, and we are well punished for doing so. Oh dear, no, they are as happy as possible. And as for trusting us, it is tragic how much they trust us.
Perfectly tragic.
Quietly,
certainly not comic, Lord Goring. How unkind of you to suggest such a thing.
I'm afraid Lord Goring is in the camp of the enemy as usual. I saw him talking to that Mrs. Cheeverly when he came in.
That's a woman, Mrs. Cheeverly.
Please do not praise other women in our presence. You might wait for us to do that.
Anyways, oh, let's join in the other guests.
Oh no, I can't stand your English house parties. In England, people actually try.
try to be brilliant at breakfast. That is so dreadful of them. Only dull people are brilliant at breakfast. And then there's a family skeleton, always reading family prayers. No, my stay in England really depends upon you, Sir Robert.
Seriously?
Quite serious. In fact, I wanted to speak to you about a great political and financial scheme. About this Argentine Canal Company, in fact.
What a tedious, practical subject you can talk to me about, Mrs. Cheeley.
But I like tedious, practical subjects. What I don't like are tedious, practical people. There is a wide difference. Besides, you are interested in these international canal schemes. You were Reading Secretary, weren't you, when the government bought the Suez Canal shares?
Yes, but the Suez Canal was a very great and splendid undertaking. It gave us our direct route to India. It had imperial value. This Argentine scheme is a common stock exchange swindle.
A speculation, my dear Sir Robert, a brilliant, daring speculation.
Believe me, Mrs. Cheeley, it is a swindle. Let us call things by their proper names. It makes matters simpler. We have all the information about it back at the foreign. In fact, I sent out a special commission to inquire into the matter privately. And they report back that the works are hardly begun. And as for the money already invested, no one seems to know what has become of it. I do hope you've not invested in it. I'm sure you were far too wise to have done that.
I've invested very largely in it.
But who can advise you to do such a thing?
Your old friend and mine.
Who?
Baron Arnheim.
Ah, yes. I remember hearing at the time of his death that he'd become mixed up in the whole affair. I'm afraid I have no advice to give you, Mrs. Cheeley, except to interest yourself in something less dangerous. The success of the canal depends, of course, upon the attitude of England, and I intend to lay your reports to commissioners before the House tomorrow night.
You must not do that, Sir Robert. In your own interest, to say nothing of mine, you must not do that.
In my own interest? Whatever do you mean, Mrs. Cheeley?
My dear Sir Robert, I'm going to be quite frank with you. I want you to remove the report you intend to lay before the House on the grounds you believe that the commissioners have been prejudiced or misinformed or something. Then I want you to say, in a few words to the effect, that you think the government should rethink the question and that you believe the canal, if completed, will be of great international value. You know the kind of things ministers say, cases of this kind. A few ordinary platitudes will do. Will you do that for me?
You could not be serious in making me such a proposition.
Quite serious.
Pray allow me to believe that you are not.
Oh, but I am. And if you do as I say, I shall pay you very handsomely.
Pay me?
Yes.
I'm afraid I don't quite understand what you mean.
How very disappointing. And I've come all the way from Vienna in order that you thoroughly understand me.
I fear I don't.
I'm speaking to a man who laid the foundations of his fortune selling to a stock exchange speculator a cabinet secret.
What do you mean?
I know the real origin of your wealth and your career. And I have your letter too. The letter you wrote Baron Arnheim, when your Lord Radley's secretary, in telling the Baron to buy the Suez Canal shares, a letter dated 3 days before the government made its own purchase.
It's not true.
It's a swindle, Sir Robert. Let us call things by their proper names. It makes everything so much simpler. And now I'm going to sell your letter, and the price I ask for it is your public of the Argentine scheme. You made your fortune out of one canal. You now must help me and my friends make a fortune out of another.
The affair to which you allude was no more than a speculation. The house had not yet passed the bill. It is infamous what you propose, infamous.
Oh no, it's a game of life as we all have to play it, Sir Robert, sooner or later.
I cannot do what you ask of me.
You must. You mean you must? Can't do it. You realise you're standing on the edge of a precipice, and it's not for you to make the terms, it's for you to accept them. Supposing you refuse.
What then?
Oh, my dear Sir Robert, what then? You are ruined, that is all. And yours is a very nasty scandal. You can't survive it. For the moment, I am your enemy, and I am much stronger than you are. The big battalions are on my side. You have a splendid position, but it's your splendid position that makes you so vulnerable. You can't survive it, and I'm on the attack.
Stop. You want me to withdraw the report and make a short speech stating that I believe there are possibilities in the scheme?
Yes, that is agreed.
I will pay you any sum of money you want.
Even you are not rich enough, Sir Robert, to buy back your past.
I will do anything you ask of me. I will not do anything you ask of me.
You must, if you don't.
Wait, wait. You said you'd give me back my letter, didn't you?
That is agreed. I'll be in the ladies' gallery tomorrow night at 11:30. If by that time I will have heaps of opportunity, you present it to the court in the terms I wish, I shall give you back your letter with the prettiest thanks, or the best at any rate, the most suitable compliment I can give. I intend to play quite fairly with you.
My dear Robert, this is a very awkward business, very awkward indeed. You should have told your wife the whole thing. Secrets from other people's wives are a necessary luxury in modern life. But no man should have a secret from his own wife. She invariably finds out. Women have a wonderful instinct about these things. They can discover everything, except the obvious.
Arthur, I couldn't tell my wife. When could I have told her? Not last night. It would have caused a lifelong separation between us, and I would have lost the love of the one woman in the world I worship, or the only woman who's ever stirred love within me. Last night it would have been quite impossible. She would have turned from me in horror and in contempt.
Is Lady Chiltern as perfect as all that?
Yes, my wife is as perfect as all that.
What a pity. I beg your pardon, my dear fellow, I didn't quite mean it like that. But if what you say is true, I'd like to have a serious talk about life with Lady Chiltern.
You'd be quite useless.
May I try?
Yes, but nothing can make her alter her views.
Well, at the worst, it would simply be a psychological experiment.
All such experiments are terribly dangerous.
Everything is dangerous, my dear fellow. If it wasn't, life wouldn't be worth living. Well, I'm bound to say that you should have paid all that you do.
When we were engaged? Do you think she would have married me if she knew the basis of my career was such as it is? The origin of my fortune such as it is? And that I've done the thing I suppose most men would call shameful and dishonourable?
Yes, most men would call it ugly names, there's no doubt of that.
Men who each day do something of the same kind themselves. Men who each one of them have worse secrets in their own lives.
That is the reason they're so keen to find out other people's secrets. It distracts public attention from their own.
And anyway, whom did I harm by what I did? Nobody.
Except yourself, Robert.
Of course, I had private information about a certain transaction contemplated by the government of the day, and I acted on it. Private information is practically the source of every large modern fortune.
And public scandal invariably the result.
It would ruin me. Arthur, the only thing for me to do now is fight the thing out.
I was waiting for you to say that, Robert. Yes, that is the only thing to do now. And you must begin by telling your wife the whole story.
I can't do that.
Robert, believe me, you are wrong.
I couldn't do it. It would kill her love for me. And about this woman, this Mrs. Cheevy, how do I defend myself against her? You knew her once before, apparently.
Yes.
Did you know her well?
So little that I got engaged to be married to her once at the Tembys. The affair lasted for 3 days. Nearly.
Why did you break it off?
Oh, I forget. Or at least it doesn't matter. By the way, have you tried her with money? She used to be confoundedly fond of money.
I offered her any sum she wanted. She refused.
Then the marvellous gospel of gold breaks down sometimes. The rich can't do everything after all.
Not everything. I suppose you're right. Arthur, I feel that public disgrace is in store for me. I feel certain of it. I did not know terror before. I know it now. It is as if a hand of ice was laid upon one's heart. It is as if one's heart was beating itself to death in some empty hollow.
Robert, you must fight her. You must fight her.
But how?
I have the smallest idea. But everybody has a weakness. There are some faults in each one of us. My mother told me that I have faults. Maybe I do. I don't know.
In defending myself, I'm just cheating. Do I not have the right to use any weapon I can find?
In your position, I wouldn't have the smallest scruple in doing so. She is thoroughly well able to look after herself.
Well, I shall send a silent telegram to the Embassy of Vienna to inquire if there's anything known against her. There may be some secret scandal she might be afraid of. Hush, what is it?
Oh, good afternoon, Lord Goring.
Good afternoon, Lady Chiltern. Have you been in the park?
No. I have come from the Women's Liberal Association, where, by the way, Robert, your name was received with loud applause. And now I've come in to have my tea. You'll wait and have some tea, won't you?
I will wait a short time, thanks.
I need spots at the club. I have some letters right there.
Robert, you work too hard. You seem never to think of yourself. You're looking so tired.
It's nothing, dear.
Do sit down. I'm so glad you called. I want to talk to you about...
You want to talk to me about Mrs. Cheevely?
Yes, you guessed it. After you left last night, I discovered that what she said was really true. Of course, I made Robert write her a letter at once, withdrawing his promise.
So he gave me to understand.
To have kept it would have been the first stain on a career that has been stainless always. Robert must be above reproach. He's not like other men. He cannot afford to do what other men do. Don't you agree with me? Speak frankly.
Lady Chiltern, I have sometimes thought that maybe you can be a bit hard in some of your views. I think that perhaps you don't make sufficient allowances. In every nature, there is some weakness, or worse than weakness. Say, for instance, that any public figure, my mother, Lord Merton, or Robert, say, had years ago written some foolish letter to someone.
What do you mean by a foolish letter?
A letter gravely compromising one's position. I'm just putting an imaginary case.
Robert is as incapable of doing a foolish thing as he is of doing a wrong thing.
Nobody is incapable of doing a foolish thing. Nobody is incapable of doing a wrong thing.
Are you a pessimist? What will the other dandies say? They will all have to go into mourning.
No, Lady Chiltern, I am not a pessimist. All I do know is that life cannot be understood without much charity, cannot be lived without much charity. It is love, and not German philosophy, that is the explanation of this world, whatever may be the explanation of the next. And if you are ever in trouble, Lady Chiltern, come to me and I will help you in every way I can. If you ever want me, come to me and I will help you. Come at once to me.
Lord Goring, you're talking very seriously. I don't think I've ever heard you talk seriously before.
Please excuse me, Lady Chiltern. It won't occur again if I can help it.
Evening, everyone. I have here a letter from Lord Reading. writes about the missing third act of this play. This missive begins, "Come on, you arse." I do hope I pronounced that correctly. Once Goring leaves, at the end of this scene, Mrs. Cheveley unexpectedly appears. In search of a brooch she lost the previous evening. Incensed at Sir Robert's reneging on his promise, she exposes Sir Robert's scandalous past to his wife. Lady Chiltern, shocked, denounces her husband and refuses to forgive him.
No.
In the third act, set in Lord Goring's home, Goring receives a pink note from Lady Chiltern asking for his help. A note that might be misread by some as a compromising love note. A short visit follows from Sir Robert, who now plans to resign from his government post in order to win back his wife's love. Meanwhile, Mrs. Cheveley arrives unexpectedly, and while she waits, she finds Lady Chiltern's note, steals it, and vengefully plans to send it to Sir Robert, misconstrued as a love letter to Lord Goring. When she and Lord Goring confront each other, Mrs. Cheveley falls for a trick of Lord Goring's and hands over Sir Robert's compromising letter, which Goring then burns. Mrs. Cheveley, down but not out, leaves the house in triumph, with Lady Chiltern's note in her possession. So, at the end of Act 3, it's Mrs. Cheveley 2, Lord Goring 1. Lord Reading ends his letter with the refrain, "Blue Army, hurrah!" We rejoin the action in Act 4.
I have a certain amount of very good news to tell you. Mrs. Cheveley gave me up Robert's letter last night and I burnt it. Robert is now safe.
Oh, I'm so glad of that. Oh, you're such a good friend to him, you're going to us.
There is only one person who could be said to be in any danger now.
Who's that?
Yourself.
I'm in danger? What do you mean?
Danger is... perhaps too great a word. It is a word that I should not have used. But I have something to tell you that may distress you, that distresses me terribly. Yesterday evening, you wrote me a very beautiful womanly letter asking for my help. You wrote to me as one of your oldest friends, one of your husband's oldest friends. Mrs. Cheveley stole that letter from my rooms.
Well, what use is it to her? Why should she not have it?
Lady Chiltern, I will be frank. Mrs. Cheveley puts a certain construction on that letter and intends to send it to your husband.
Gertie, here is the draft of my resignation letter. Shall I read it to you?
Lies are rolled round curves of emotion. It's upon these lines of intellect that a man's life progresses. I've just learnt this, and much else in Lord Glory. And I will not spoil your life for you, nor you spoil it for me as a sacrifice.
Oh, Gertrude.
Men can forget. You can forget. Men easily can forget. And I can forgive. And that's how women help the world. I see that now.
My wife. Oh, my wife. Arthur, it seems that I'm always to be in your debt.
No, no, Robert. Your debt is to Lady Chiltern, not to me.
Oh, no, I owe you much. But Ermia, what were you going to ask before Lady Caversham came in?
Robert, you are your sister's guardian. I would like your consent to my marriage with her. That is all.
Oh, I'm so glad. My sister, to be your wife.
Yes.
I'm sorry, it's out of the question. I have to think of Mabel's happiness, and I don't think her happiness would be safe in your hands. And I cannot have a sacrifice.
Sacrificed?
Yes. Utterly sacrifice. Loveless marriages are horrible, but there is one thing that is worse than a loveless marriage. A marriage where there is love, but from one side only. Faith from one side only. Devotion from one side only. And of the two hearts in it, one is sure to be broken.
But I love Mabel. No other woman has any place in my life.
Robert, if they love each other, they should be married.
Arthur cannot offer Mabel the love she deserves.
What makes you say that?
Do you really want me to tell you?
Certainly I do.
As you choose. When I called on you yesterday evening, I found Mrs. Chigney concealed in one of your rooms. It was between 10 and 11 o'clock in the night. I'll say no more. The relations you have with Mrs. Chigney, as I told you last night, do not concern me. But I know you're engaged to be married to her once. The fascination she exercised on you then seems to have returned. Yesterday, you spoke of her as of a woman pure and stainless, whom you honored and respected. And that may be so, but I cannot trust Mabel's life into your hands. It would be wrong of me. It would be unjust, infamously unjust.
I have nothing more to say.
Robert, it was not Lord Goring. It was not Mrs. Cheveley who Lord Goring expected to see last night.
Lady Chiltern.
Not Mrs. Cheveley. Who was it?
It was your own wife. Robert, yesterday Lord Goring said if ever I was in trouble, I could come to him for help and advice, as he is our oldest and best friend. Later on, after the incident in his room, I wrote to Lord Goring and told him I trusted him. I needed him. I was coming to him for help and advice. Yes, that letter. But I didn't go in the end. I felt it was to ourselves alone that help could come. Pride made me think of that. Mrs. Cheveley went. She stole my letter, and she sent it to you anonymously this morning so that you'd think, oh, Robert, I can't tell you what she wished you to think.
What? And I've fallen so low in your eyes to think just for a moment of the doubt of your goodness. Arthur, go to Mabel and you have my wishes. But wait a minute, this letter has no name. This brilliant Mrs. Cheveley doesn't seem to have noticed. It should have a name.
Oh, let me write yours. It's you who I need and trust and no one else.
Oh, Lady Chiltern, I think I should have back my own letter.
No, you shall have Mabel.
Oh, I hope she hasn't changed her mind. It's been 20 minutes since I saw her last.
Lord Goring, I find your mother's conversation much more improving than yours. I'm only going to speak to Lady Caversham from now on.
Oh, darling.
What does this mean, sir? You don't mean to tell me that this charming, clever young lady has been foolish enough to accept you?
Yes, certainly, Mother. And Chiltern has been wise enough to accept the seat in the cabinet.
I'm very glad to hear it, Chiltern. And if the country doesn't go to the dogs or the radicals, we shall have you Prime Minister one day.
Luncheon is on the table, my lady.
You'll stay for luncheon, won't you, Lady Harrison?
With pleasure. And afterwards I shall drive to Downing Street with you, Chiltern. You have a fine future ahead of you. A fine future. Which is more than can be said for you, sir. Your career will have to be entirely domestic.
Yes, Mother, I prefer it domestic.
If you do not make this young lady an ideal husband, I shall cut you off without a shilling.
An ideal husband? Oh, I don't think I should like that. It sounds like something of the next world.
But what do you want him to be, dear?
He can be what he chooses.